Hello, everybody.
We're going to talk about the truth behind 5 college admissions lies that you've been told. I've been at this for almost 30 years, and I hear everything that you hear. I have a high school senior, I have Facebook, I have Instagram, I see all the ads, I get mailers in the mail, I know what's happening out there. We got to talk about some things because there's a lot of stuff going around that just ain't true, my friends, so we're going to cut right through it. Number one. You probably have been taught to believe that the more selective a college is, the better it is. Have you heard that the harder it is to get into a school or the more popular the school is, the better it is? Maybe you think that a good school is one that's ranked top 25 or top 50 or it's ranked in US News and World Report. Maybe you think the only way a school is good is if it's one that you've heard of. That, wow, if it's easy to get into, it must be a really bad school. So let's go ahead and cut through this right now and tell you why all of this is just one big lie. I want to talk about 2 pieces. The first is what makes a college selective, and the second is what does better even mean? Number one, what makes a college selective? Popularity. But guess what colleges do in order to gain popularity, to improve their ranking? They send out lots of free applications. They do things like, hey, if you apply, you don't need to write an essay. Hey, here's a free fee waiver. Oh, you took the PSAT? We want you. You should apply here. All of these things are fake. They do it in order to drive up their application numbers, in order to be more selective. Because the higher their rejection rate, the greater their rank will be at US News and World Report. That's what makes a college selective. It's a popularity contest. What else makes it selective? Brand power, market power. The more money a college has, the more they're able to drive up their marketing and put everything out. Just because a college is selective does not make it better. It just means that more students are applying. And what does better even mean? What does it mean for a school to be better? What are you looking for in a school for your child? What makes a school better is whatever your teen needs in order to be healthy, in order to be happy, in order to be successful, in order to meet whatever ROI, return on investment, you, your child feels needs to happen after graduation from that college. This is all really subjective, my friends. You need to read Fit Over Rankings by Challenge Success, which is out of Stanford. It's going to bust this myth that prestige is what ultimately will determine your teen's success. You know what determines your teen's success? How engaged they are in college, their connection with their professors, whether or not they know what to do and how to connect on campus. That is what matters most, and it is well researched. So, the more selective the school, the better it is. False. Not true. Big lie. Number 2. Have you heard this? Rigor matters most. Rigor matters most. 2 colleges, if your teen isn't taking really hard classes, they won't get into college. You heard that? Have you heard that your teen better take and challenge themselves as much as they possibly can, or they're not gonna get in because rigor matters most? We're gonna go ahead and break this apart right now. First of all, what do colleges even mean by rigor? Colleges define rigor as what challenges your teen. They want your teen to have a challenging curriculum. They don't want your teen to just float by in classes and not be intellectually challenged. They want your teen to feel challenged. Do they want your teen to feel over their head? Do they want your teen to tread water? Do they want your teen to sacrifice his or her mental health for the sake of rigor? No, they don't. For the rigor matters most piece, that would mean your student taking just about every challenging class they could possibly take to fill their schedule. Every year, every subject, all the way through. That type of education and the need for the academics on that, we're really only talking about 3 or 4% of the colleges in the United States that are gonna want that. If that scares your teen, if your teen isn't capable of that, they probably wouldn't do that well at those highly selective colleges anyway if they got in. So rigor matters most is really only for a certain subset of schools, and it would be the uber, uber selective schools, okay? In the admissions formula, my college admissions course for parents, I talk about different levels of students, and one level isn't better than another. And we go through and I say, okay, if your student is going to look at these types of colleges with these types of admit rates, this is really what they're going to need as a basis. to go from. It's all a choice. Rigor matters most for some schools, but for the majority of the schools in the nation, colleges just want your teen to challenge himself or herself to the best of their ability without going overboard. I firmly believe that we are putting way too much pressure on our teens too early, and it's important for our teens to know that they don't have to do everything. They don't have to take all of these classes. They don't. And that rigor doesn't matter most. What matters is their mental health and them being comfortable and happy and enjoying their high school experience so they can be happy and successful when they get to college. So lie. 80% of colleges accept more than half of the applicants that apply. 80%, that's a lot. And there's lots and lots of space, and I come at this from a place of abundance. Every single student, there is a place for your teen, I promise you. And number three, have you ever wondered if your teen isn't doing enough? Have you wondered, gosh, they're not doing enough test prep. They're not doing enough hard classes. They're not doing enough activities. They're not doing enough community service. Well, they're doing this, but they're not doing that. Of course you have. It's natural for us to do that. And the sad reality of why it's natural is because advertising has forced us to do that. We get the same ads. I used to read Mademoiselle and Cosmo. It's always that something's missing in our life, right? You're not doing enough. Your home isn't clean enough. Your waistline isn't thin enough. Your eyelashes aren't full enough. Your brows aren't thick enough. There's always these problems. There's always something missing on us. We've been brainwashed to believe the same thing about college admission. And what's happening is now our teens feel like they're not enough. Look at the culture that we have right now. Look at the social media that we have right now. Our teens are constantly influenced by influencers that have all these followers, and they're just the best. Our teens are constantly comparing themselves. More than likely, your teen is doing enough to be able to get into some really, really fantastic schools. And if you're getting pushed into believing that your teen needs a passion project and that they have a job but they better do community service, or they're in one club but it's not enough, I wanna tell you that that's not how colleges review applications. And so I wanna be really, really clear on that. Passion project? Only if it's really, really authentic and it's something they consistently do for quite a bit and it shows a depth of understanding about a subject, maybe it'll help. I was a reader for UC. We don't pick up an application and say, gosh, I wish they did more. I wish their activities list was longer. They had more stuff. You don't do that. What we're trying to figure out is, what makes this teen tick? What do they care about? What history am I looking at with their resume, activities list, with their transcript, with all these things that I'm getting in this application? What does the history say about what a teen cares about, what their contributions will be? When you're thinking about, is my teen doing enough? Look at your teen and do they have something positive and healthy that they're doing, that they like, that they enjoy? Is there anything that they do that makes them happy? When I'm working with students, I ask them, if you had unstructured time where no one was telling you to do something, you didn't have a commitment that you had to be at, you just had free time, what would you do at that time? Sometimes it's hard for them to answer it because they're like, I don't have that. And that always freaks me out a little bit because in college, they're gonna have quite a bit of free time. But the ones that are able to be like, I would do this, fifth season of rowing, basketball, pep band, reading graphic novels, how amazing is that? That's the kind of stuff that colleges love to see because they wanna know that your teen has something healthy, something that makes them happy, something that makes them feel connected to themselves. Let's try to move away from this. Let's check all the boxes and make sure they're doing stuff for themselves and doing some for their community and doing some for their school. Let's try to move away from that and get back to what makes your teen happy, healthy. I've seen the passion project and what do you do over the summer? Again, for some of that, you're looking at the smallest selection of colleges that aren't looking for a passion project. They're looking for depth. They're looking for what does your teen care about. That's the kind of stuff that's really gonna matter. Number four, how many of you have heard this, that going to a summer program on a college campus is going to improve your teen's chances of admission at that school? How many of you have ever heard that? Like, if you go to Emory's summer program, you're gonna have a better shot, or Chicago, or Northwestern, or out here at the U. You go to the summer program, it's a way of demonstrating your interest. No, the summer programs aren't there to help your teen demonstrate interest to that school. Why do colleges offer summer programs? And I'll tell you Wow, have they picked up in the last few years? They went away with COVID. And guess what happened when they went away with COVID? Colleges lost so much money. Because guess what the summer programs are for? To bring in revenue over the summer because buildings are mostly empty. Usually it's rented out to a third-party program. Sometimes the colleges run it themselves, but again, it's a revenue-driving effort. These one-week courses, these two-week courses, you probably get the same invitations that I've gotten. Your child has been nominated for the National Youth Leadership Forum on Medicine or on Law. Any of you got those? Where do those take place? Often on college campuses. Summer programs, not something that your teen needs. It's not gonna help them to gain admission. It doesn't work that way. Now, of course, there are the ones that are more competitive, the ones that are highly selective programs where you need to apply to get in and only 12 students or something get in out of thousands. That's a little bit different. That's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about the ones that you're getting in the mail, the same ones I get in the mail, that are inviting your teen to spend $5,000 to $7,000 to go there for a couple weeks over the summer. Trash it, my friends. When wouldn't you trash it? Well, if your teen is really interested in that topic and they want to go just to immerse themselves in it, maybe to find out if that's what they want to major in or something, no problem. I definitely have clients that did it a couple times this summer and he actually decided he didn't want to go into a certain major because he went through it. So fine, that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. But be careful about the lie that come to the summer program and it's going to help to increase your teen's chance of admission. Number five, have you heard this? You need a certain amount of community service hours in order to be competitive for college admission. Have you heard that before? I see this all the time. A lot of the nonprofit organizations around here will say things like, come get your community service hours. It's great for college admission. And I'm like, why is it great for college admission? Where are you getting this information? Okay, school gets it too. Come after school to help with the recycling club and get your community service hours for college admission. Now, some of your high schools have community service hours that are built into the requirements for graduation. I'm not talking about that. But your teen doesn't need community service hours. They don't need hours. It doesn't work that way. Some students don't have any community service. Your teen needs to stop counting hours like it's jail time. I get this all the time. I'll say to a student, what is something you care about that you do? And they'll say, well, I did 10 hours of community service. I'm like, oh yeah, but that's not the question I asked. What cause do you care about? And they'll say, well, I did a couple hours of a beach cleanup and I did a couple hours of that. And I'm like, you're not answering the question. Is there a cause behind that? What do you do related to the community service? So that is the piece that colleges care about. The colleges care about the cause behind the service. So if your teen is involved in community service, hopefully it'll be around a specific cause. Maybe it's homelessness. Maybe they want to help people that have disabilities. There's lots of different things that students can do, but have them care more about the cause behind it. I get this question a lot. People ask, well, my son has a job. Does he also need to do community service? No, it's not a box to check. Colleges are looking at your teen's activities. They're trying to understand, what do you stand for? What do you care about? How have you spent your time? So don't be thinking of it as they have to volunteer, check. They have to do a summer program, check. Don't do that. The more you do that, the more the application will really lack authenticity. I have some students that do a lot of different things, but then when it comes to the application process and they're writing and they're talking about something they really care about, they often say, why did I do all those other activities when like I'm not even really gonna talk about them in my applications? I'm like, well, they see your resume, they see your activities list, but it gets pretty obvious what a student cares about when they choose to write about it. Have your teen focus on the things they want. You can lead them to water and help them. Here's the next one. How many of you think an A is always better than a B? Is an A always better than a B? We've been taught to think that, right? Here's the thing. When colleges are evaluating your teen's transcript, they're gonna look at a variety of things. The transcript is absolutely gonna be the most important document or the self-reported grades. So they're looking at it and they're not just going A, C, B. They're not going through and just looking at the grades. No, they're reading the whole thing. They're gonna say like, okay, well, wait. All right, here's some A's, B's. Okay, what did they get the B in? Okay, C, okay. I audit transcripts all the time and I have vast experience in schools. As an advisor, I helped with audits, thousands of transcripts from tons and tons of different school districts. I helped to teach counselors how to audit transcripts and to go through and to understand what our college is really looking for. So when I go through a transcript and I teach all about this in the admissions formula, I go through and I go, okay, So they took, you know, ninth grade English, what class did they take? 10th grade, 11th grade. I go through it and I look for, okay, did they level up? Did they level down? What types of classes are they taking? And then I'm gonna look at their grades. So hear me loud and clear when I say this. A B, and sometimes even a C, in a more rigorous course is often better than an A in a regular class. I'm gonna say that again because, oh boy, the misinformation on this one. It is often better for your teen to get a little bit of a lower grade in a more difficult class than to stay in the class that's not challenging them as much and just getting that solid A. When you look at the factors that colleges are using to review your teen's candidacy, the types of classes they're taking, the rigor of their course load, is going to be the first thing they look at, and then they're gonna recalculate the GPA. The GPA that's on your teen's transcript is often not the one used for admission. They're gonna look at that first. They're gonna look at rigor. If your grade drops a little bit and your student is learning more, they're getting more out of it, they're expanding their mind, then good. If they're going overboard and they're drowning, that's not good. Be careful if you're teens' grades drop a little bit because they're taking harder classes. Allow them to flex a little bit and to take that risk because it's gonna help their brain more than anything else. Lie number 7. Have you heard this before? That your student needs to be really careful about disclosing political beliefs, social beliefs, their background. You have to be really careful about what you disclose because colleges may not want to admit you if you have a certain belief. If you think that you need to hide a part of yourself when you're applying, why would you think that that school is a good fit for you? Because if you can't authentically be your true self in the application process and you're worried that a college is going to discriminate against you because of who you really are, then maybe your list is wrong. Maybe you're applying to the wrong colleges. What I make sure I tell any parent, especially with anything that has to do with LGBTQ, learning disabilities, my kid has ADD, should we talk about it? My student has some kind of learning difference, should we not talk about it? It's always up to the student whether or not they feel comfortable sharing. But wouldn't you want your teen to go to a school where they're going to be fully comfortable and supported with all of their needs? If you even remotely are thinking that, I hope that you'll have an honest, authentic conversation with your teen. So always leave it up to your student with whether or not they want to share parts of themselves and what they want to disclose. But please know that my philosophy and what I always tell clients is, if it's who you are and you've struggled with it and you've come out the other side, why not share that growth? Why not talk about that experience? Because it shows really who you are and what you stand for. Lie number 8. How about the lie that this is not your process? You need to back off and take a back seat. I'm gonna tell you the number one comment that I get on my sponsored ads when I'm putting out the information about my masterclass. Why would this be just a class for parents? This should be for students too. This isn't the parents' job to build the list. This is a huge investment, a huge investment. It is a partnership, my friends. I am not teaching you how to be a helicopter parent. I am helping you to help your teen to create a beautiful list of colleges that makes sense for your family. Don't take a back seat. Sit next to them. Help them. This is difficult. This is a really confusing, complicated process. There's usually not a college application or college admissions 101 class. This is the biggest investment that you're gonna make. It's the highest stakes thing that your teen has probably ever done. I give you full permission to ask the right questions, to gain the knowledge that you need to know, to be armed and ready so that way when things come down the chute, you've got the tools that you need to go, my friends, okay, to help. And that's what this process needs to be about. Now, in the college application process, I'll be completely honest, and with my own clients, I'm like, hey, we got this. Because sometimes over-meddling, asking questions all the time, harping on them, it's gonna block their creativity and it's gonna make it really difficult for them to write these great applications. But there are definitely pieces of the process where it needs to be a partnership. And in the admissions formula, my 10-week college admissions course for parents, we talk about that. Whose role is it anyway? Who should be doing what? And how do you guide your teen? And when do you back off? And how do you work with that balance? I think it's really important for you to be proactive, for you to really get in there and to know what's going on because this is such a huge decision. Lie number 9 is this. I understand right now that applications are up at the most selective colleges. Last year, the numbers were like 25% more increase or something in applications at the selective schools. And I understand that that causes a lot of anxiety and it causes a lot of confusion because you start to think, well, what does it really take to get in? And trying to figure out what these strategies are. And I get it. And I'm like that too. But there's a bit of a lie and misconception here that I want to talk about. People are applying to a lot more colleges than they did before. I think this year the Common App came out with data that it was like 6.4 colleges or something is the average that students applied to this year, and it was up from a little bit under 6 or something. We averaged it out. I tell clients this. I say, because of what's happening in the environment, you need to apply more broadly. I say that a lot. So maybe people aren't lying when they use that word, but they're not explaining it the right way. I'm hearing that people are applying to 20 plus schools and just throwing these applications out. That's not what it means to apply broadly. What it means to apply broadly is to help broaden your teen's mind about what great options are out there and help them to diversify the types of schools they're applying to that fit them. When I say apply broadly, I'm not saying apply all over the place and increase the amount of applications that are coming out. You need to just make sure that you're really more closely defining what works for your teen and making sure that you're aligning the college list to those factors. So someone asked a question and they said, public school counselor, and I'm not ripping on public school counselors, I'm just telling her what she said. She was talking about the University of California system, and she said, if we apply to the UCs, which there are 11 of them, it counts as one school. And I was like, no, all the UCs are different. They're all different, and that's what drives up the numbers. If you're like, oh, just throw an application out to this UC and that UC and this UC, but your teen doesn't understand what it is that differentiates those schools, then you're not building the list right. You might be hearing that I think is like a lie, but, oh, you know, you should apply to 12, 15, 20 schools. I don't think that's true, and I still don't do that with my own clients. It's not what I teach to parents in the admissions formula. There's a reasonable way to go through this. It is crazy town, banana cakes, for your students to do that many applications. It just takes forever, and it's so exhausting and draining in the senior year, and if you're a parent of a senior, then you get it. And I think that's it. Bye-bye.